You may be seated. Our scripture reading this morning is found in the book of the Psalms, Psalm 132. We read this morning from verse 1 up until verse 9. Psalm 132, verse 1 to verse 9.
Good morning, everyone. Lord, do not forget David and all the hardship he endured. Remember, Lord, what he had promised, the vow he made to you, the mighty God of Jacob. I will not go home or go to bed. I will not rest or sleep until I provide a place for the Lord, a home for the mighty God of Jacob. In Bethlehem, he heard about the covenant box, and we found it in the field of Jerusalem. We said, let us go to the Lord's house. Let us worship before his throne. Come to the temple, Lord, with the covenant box, the symbol of your power, and stay here forever. May your priests do always what is right. May your people shout for joy. This is the word of God.
Come, let us pray. May the words of my mouth, O God, and the meditations of our hearts, may they be pleasing in your sight, you, O God, who has always been our rock and our redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Friends, I have entitled my sermon this morning, Thanks versus Requests, or Requests versus Thanks, whichever way you want to put that this morning, and thought that I wonder if I had to ask across the room this morning, what's your understanding of gratitude or of thanksgiving? What words would you conquer? And I think this morning, it's apt to say that if we look at thanksgiving or at gratitude as a noun, it would sound like this. It's the quality of being thankful. The readiness to show appreciation for and to return kindness. And I wonder whether we have sat for a moment on Thanksgiving Sunday to think that this is really what it's all about. Now, I remember that that Zana grew up at a time in America, am I right? And you would recall, Zanele, that there were moments that you celebrated Thanksgiving. So in those moments of Thanksgiving, growing up in America, for instance, would you have thought that it's any different to what happens in Swaziland and in South Africa? No different. Whether we are in one part of the world or in the next part of the world, what Thanksgiving creates, it creates a togetherness, isn't it? I'm wanting for you to think about what you do on Thanksgiving Day when you slaughter turkey turn. Do you still slaughter a turkey? Sometimes. But it's about those moments in our lives where we bestow gratitude, isn't it? And it's easy to bestow gratitude when we don't do it in isolation. It's far difficult when we do gratitude in isolation. I was visiting Louise this week, and I was just aware how hard isolation can be for one of us, isn't it? It's not an easy thing to be gratitude when you sit by yourself. To have gratitude when you sit by yourself. So we listen to the text this morning, and we hear that the text starts with a word, and it opens up like this, and it says, Lord, do not forget David and all the hardships he endured. And so when we listen to that, it's as if we hear a request, isn't that? It's as if someone is interceding on behalf of David. And so in our world today, the first thing about our world is that there are people that intercede for us. So that's the Sunday school making their way out. and they get collected. And we're grateful that we have a Sunday school here, because I think that which I remember the most are my moments when I engaged Sunday school. I'm blessed today for the first time, and I'm going to acknowledge this just in the space of Sunday school. I have Clarice here. Clarice is from Queenstown, where I was minister as well. And I know Clarice since she was born. And when Clarice was born, the thing that I needed to ensure was that Clarice needed to get to Sunday school. And so Clarice had lots of long hair. And it was always painstaking, almost me wanting to tell her late, mom, can you do her hair the day before and plait them? Because to plait them in the morning took quite a lot of time because it was that long. And so I see this morning she's been wise, she's cut them very short. And so we're grateful for hairdressers, Clarice. Yeah. And so we wanna bless God for the moments in our lives when we have intercessors, to get back to that point. Can you hear that someone says about David, Lord, can you remember his hardships? So it's not easy to identify who your prayer partners are. Do you have any idea who prays for you when you go about your business as normal? I don't have an idea who prays for me on a daily basis, but I know that I cannot get through my day if it's not for the prayer warriors that God has put in place. I know that I cannot get through my day if there's not someone calling my name before the throne of God. And just for that, I am deeply indebted to those people who have not made themselves known. Please don't tell me if you're praying for me. Just continue to do it. But more than that, the text says that today is also about the covenants we made with God. Have you ever made a covenant with God where you said, God, if you help me with this, I promise you I will do that? Have you been there, Tony? I think I've been there. I don't know whether you recall having a word with your brothers, and I don't know whether you were there, and I would say how careless I would be driving my car from South Africa across the border, and 5 Ks before the border, I would free it because I'd run out of petrol. Because in my mind, I'm thinking if I cross the border of Swaziland, the petrol's cheaper. There's no tax implications. And so I risk a lot. So imagine if that car would just stop. And I remember Doug looking at me and saying, Craig, that's not very responsible. And I thought, Dad, you're younger than me. You don't know anything about this stuff. But in those spaces, friends, in those spaces, it's about really putting ourselves at risk and hoping God will do the rest, isn't it? Am I the only one like that? I think all of us are in those spaces where, let me use this word carelessly, where we gamble, where we take a sheer risk. And in taking those sheer risks in our lives, we get to moments where we can either say, oh, I'm not doing that again. Or we sit and we reflect and we think, wow, thank you, God. I remember getting to the border gate. And as I get to the border gate, all I would pray for is, please let them recognize me and not stop me, so that I can free the car. And then I stand and I look around and I see who can talk to me and greet me. And not because I wanted to greet anyone, simply because I wanted them to push the car out of reverse so that I can free it onto the Swazi side. The things we do. And the things that I am grateful for. Because there would be many a night that I would do that just before 9 at night. And the danger I place myself in. And maybe that's where Doug is right. But it's also about the moments where we make a commitment. That Thanksgiving is about our commitments that we make. So let me ask you, what are the commitments that you make? What's your child's name, Iris?
Jared.
Jared. Yeah. It's about the commitment that you made for Jared to provide him adequate education, adequate food. Just simple examples. For your son to provide for things that we don't even know what they do with the spending we give them. And that this moment is the moment when we come to God and we say, God, I want to thank you for the privilege and the grace that you have bestowed upon me so that I may be able to do the things that I have committed myself to. And so this morning, we really also come to worship God. I was going through anxiety in this week, and in my anxiety moments, I said to my secretary, please find me someone that would be willing in this church, in the 9 o'clock service, to come and pay.
I asked for strength.
To come and pay a testimony. And so I found someone to pay a testimony, because I don't believe that Thanksgiving Sunday is about me doing a sermon. I believe that Thanksgiving Sunday is about us hearing the stories of God's people. And so I have one person that will give me a story of God's people and what she has gone through. Now, this is me waiting for you to get here. And for what she has gone through and for how God has been with her through this very difficult stage of her life. So tell me, what are you thankful for?
Good morning, everyone. So I'm very thankful for the congregation and the community. So I'm very thankful for the congregation and the community at Parktown North. As most of you might know, 5 years ago, I stood at this very podium giving thanks for the opportunity to pursue my tertiary studies, which wouldn't have been possible had it not been for Wendy Alvey, Father Jack, the Parktown North Education Task Team, and FNB. And through that opportunity, I was able to study stress-free and complete 2 of my degrees and receive so much support. And even throughout my studies, I, as a normal student, was worried about what will I do when I finish studying. And so because of my citizenship being contentious and still being uncertain, I thought, what's the point of me studying when I can't practice afterwards? And a lot of the time when I had these doubts, I would speak to Liz, a lot of the church members, and my mom would always say, don't you trust God? Just trust him to take care of the rest. You've done your bit, you've worked hard, you've studied, and you'll come out. God didn't bring you this far to just leave you. And so with the faith and the fear, I just continued working hard, and I'm so grateful and thankful to say that today I was awarded a Mandela Rhodes Scholarship to pursue my master's studies. And out of 6,000 applicants on the continent and 4 elimination rounds, I was selected in the final 30. And I'm so, I think thankful is the key word. I'm gonna keep repeating it. I'm so grateful, and I'm so grateful that I was afforded this opportunity. And as I was chatting to Liz 2 weeks ago in her office, I received a call where I had applied for a fellowship to work at a firm in Rosebank. And as I was chatting to Liz, I received that call and was told that my application was successful. And so I'll also be working there in 2022. So there's a lot to be grateful for. And there was a lot of turning your lemons into lemonade and trying to do what I could with what I had, and all of which wouldn't have been possible without, like Craig said, having people that you don't even know pray for you and have you in their hearts and minds. And yeah, so I'm so, so grateful for that.
And for me, that's Thanksgiving Sunday. Thanksgiving Sunday finds new meaning in spaces where we listen to what God is doing in our lives. So I'm going to give an ad hoc space and say, is there anyone else that wants to give thanks? And if not, then that's also okay. You don't need to feel, yes, Louise. Thank you, Louise. And so it's those moments that bring us out of isolation, Louise was alone, and brings us into community where we share the stuff that we go through and the stuff that we experience. But far more than that, it's also the moment in our lives where we can come to worship in the temple. I think there are people, I have been in spaces throughout my ministry in many years where I've had to plant churches. And I recall churches and spaces that had no buildings and just trees and just people sitting underneath the trees. And what that meant for people on the day when we had completed a structure. Not only buildings like this, but also schools. What it meant for a community when I have been part of erecting school structures. And how grateful people were. And these are the things that we are thankful for. Sometimes I'm not always sure how God works in these spaces. I'd sent out this video clip about I prayed for, and I'm going to ask you to play that because I want you to hear it. And I want you to hear it this morning that sometimes what we ask for, request versus thanksgiving, is not how God executes it. So I want us to play that video. It's up on there.
And God gave me difficulties to make me strong. I asked for wisdom. And God gave me problems to solve. I asked for courage. And God gave me dangers to overcome. I asked for love. And God gave me troubled people to help. My prayers were answered.
And it's really difficult. And I think all those that are in single spaces like myself can imagine that no one that's single doesn't want to be loved. And so we go through moments in our lives where we pray that God who gift us the gift of love. And then I think, wow, God, I thought that love is about me being in, if you're happy and you know, you clap your hands and all of that. And it's not about that. Because when I ask for love, God gave me trouble. And so today it reminded me of an old familiar song that I sang as a child with my parents. And it's going to play there. Bring it up. For what I need to be thankful for, and what we all can be thankful for. Have you got it? There we go. These are just TikTok stuff, but they're still meaningful. I thank God for TikTok. Dang it. All right. Doesn't matter. But it was about a song. You can take it off. It was
for the sunshine in the air, let me weep, oh Lord. We thank thee. We thank thee for run all day. Thank thee for the little birds that sing along the way. We thank thee for the trees and the leaves of the sea. Oh Lord, we thank thee. Oh yes, we thank thee, Lord.
And so friends, it's not just about the things that are yet. It's about the things that we can see. So I ask of you this morning, what do you see? Do you still see the birds? Do you still see the blossoms? Do you still hear the wind? Do you still feel the sunshine of the day? And maybe it rains. And all God wants you to do is go out and play in the rain. Have you done that lately? I think we've grown up so big that we've forgotten how to be children again. So I thank God for my childhood. I thank God for my memories and for every life experience that God has placed my way. I thank God today for my hardships, because my hardships formed me. It made me make new sense of my experiences today. And so as you sit there this morning, as you engage your thinking, as you take a journey through the cognitive, what are the passages that you see? What are the potholes that you have experienced? And what are the joys that you can live through this morning? You see, friends, I'm thankful for the little mistakes that we make technically. It's not important. Because it teaches me patience and it teaches me how to be kind. And I think that my Thanksgiving Day is about saying to God, God, thank you that I'm not so unkind and wanting to be perfectionist all the time, because I can be a perfectionist. Thank you, God, that I don't have all my hair tweezed in the right way and I can have it wild and wonderful. I was saying to Liz the other day in the office that sometimes I have all these problems and then I wonder why my hair goes curly. But it's all moments, friends. It's all moments where God allows me growth. That's what I'm thankful for. I'm thankful for each new day. Just each new day. I'm thankful that I can breathe. Do you know, friends, that there are people that now still struggle to breathe? You know that I am quite involved in old age homes, and having gone to a few of the old age homes this past week and just doing welcoming to new members in, some don't want it to be called old age homes, but just for those who, some of them said to me, you know, Craig, I've had COVID and I still cannot smell. You know, Craig, I've had COVID and I still cannot taste. And I think it's a beautiful image. Do you have an image of a child that doesn't like something when you give them that to eat? Was your son like that? Now, let me tell you how I was. If you had given me anything that I didn't want to eat, I'd go, yeah, ah! And I'd spit it. And now I think, wow, that was just a moment in my life where I celebrated the gift of taste.
Look at you. Sure.
I now watch Tony.
At least
Tony does this to me when he cannot hear me. And when he doesn't hold his big ears, like mine, then I know he can hear me, and I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful that there
are... He prayed for us, so I'm not going to knock him anymore.
Friends, I wonder this morning whether we are at a point in our lives where we can think of one word and shout it out and say, that's what I'm thankful for this morning. If I have to give you 1 second to make one audible noise of what you are thankful for, what would that sound like? Tony, what would you be thankful for?
My life.
Your life. Friends.
Christian values.
Grandchildren. Your son. I think each one of us today come here in deep gratitude. In deep gratitude for the things that God has blessed us with and the things we have taken for granted. Salela, I'm wanting to come back to you. I'm making you part of the sermon. I'm abusing you. You're a sister. I don't care. I'm grateful for that. What makes you to be grateful for Christian values? But I want to tell you something about Zanele's family. You may not know, I stayed in their home. I didn't take her bed. I took her brother's bed. And I'm thankful for Bongani for that bed. It was his room, wasn't it? Right. But above all of that, she comes from such a deep, 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 deeply embedded Christian home. Do you know why I say that to you? Because every night, we would sit with scripture in her home. And not because I was the minister, simply because her father is a Methodist local preacher. He's emeritus now, right? Your dad doesn't preach any longer? But give him a chance, he would. Right? I'm speaking lots about them because that's the family God gave me in a foreign country. I stayed in their home. They became my sisters and my brothers. When the church had sent me to Swaziland, there was no room. There was no manse. There was just the generosity of her mom and dad to say, come and stay with us. They'd known me from no barrister. The gift of having a free meal every day for months, 6 months. And so we are thankful. We are thankful for what God does in our lives. I pray that today is not just in your mind's eye about the amount of money we give, but about this experience here. I sent out a little thing this week, and I don't know whether you can recall it. I said that the journey is not there, but the journey starts here. The journey of thankfulness starts here, in the heart. So that today is really about this experience. This experience, I got it right. What are the things in your heart that you are thankful for? May God bless you. May God pour out his countenance upon you. In Jesus' name, amen. And because it's about church, let us sing, "The Church is One Foundation." Friends, a reminder for you to invite others next week, Sunday at 5 p.m. It is the first Sunday of Advent. It's the day we put up the Christmas tree in all Christian homes. The season changes from Epiphany, no more green wearing, to maybe white and gold or whatever we've got in this church. 5 o'clock fellowship, no tea for the first Sunday of the month. In the morning service, we will have that in the evening. So if you want to be a hostess, please speak to me. Sunday next week at 5 o'clock, we're putting up the Christmas tree. And I really want you to invite little kids so that we get them involved and get you involved so that we show that we're really about being a family church. May God bless you as we sing the benediction together. Peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.